All right, hello and welcome to another Expert Insight interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM, joining you as usual from San Diego. And today I'm delighted to be joined by Nikki Nash, who is on the other side of the country in New Jersey. How are you doing, Nikki?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Excellent, excellent. And Nikki is a marketing mentor and entrepreneur and author of the book Market Your Genius. And what we're going to talk about today is an intriguing notion, creating a soul-aligned marketing plan. Okay, Nikki, let's get straight into it. What do you mean by soul-aligned?
Yes. So this is where I get, as some people like to call it, a little woo, which is always funny for folks because I love math and I spent a long time in corporate and, you know, tend to, if you're into masculine and feminine energies, tend to skew more towards masculine energy. But one of the things that I've noticed is when people are building marketing plans, they get so stuck in what other people are doing and what other people says work. And the reality is that there are probably a ton of different things that work for your business type, your business model, maybe even your target audience. But if you're not really connected to the plan that you have, especially if you're marketing yourself or you have to sell a product that you have to really believe in, if you're just going, hey, I'm going to just do what this guy said or this person said because it's worked for them, and you're not connected to it, you end up finding more often than not that it doesn't work for you or that you're not going to do it because you don't like it. And so I really encourage people to go, okay, what actually, use that intuition, like what feels good to me out of all the things that I could do, which are the things that actually feel right?
Yeah, no, that's, I agree. I mean, you're correct. And often when you're in marketing, what do? Is everybody else in the organization starts sending you, oh, look what they're doing. Here's their, oh, this looks cool. We should do something like this. And you do, you end up in this, you can end up in this cycle of constantly trying to copy other people.
Yeah. And I call their symptoms from those, oh, I'm going to try all these things. And I call one TMI for too many ideas. And people just have so many ideas that they're almost paralyzed and they don't get started. And the other one I call RSS for rapid strategy switching, where it's like squirrel, like, ooh, we could do this and we're going to start this. And you get halfway through it or you do it once and then you scrap it and you're on to the next one. And you need to give any marketing strategy time to figure out if it's going to work right for you, because there's within one plan a ton of things that maybe if you tweaked it a little bit would make it better or would make it actually work for you.
Yeah, no, that's an excellent point. And that happens all the time, you see, and especially because we live in this culture today of where people have expectations of things being instantaneous and, instant gratification. And so things are going to work. And yeah, if you're like 2 weeks into an initiative and it's not showing you like amazing results, people tend to switch. We have no patience anymore.
It's so true. And that's the very thing you need in order to see success in your business, let alone your marketing plan. And I'm like, guys, you need patience and persistence and, you know, maybe some blind optimism to keep moving forward.
Actually, listen, I'm a huge believer in blind faith. Sometimes sometimes blind belief or blind faith, that's all you have. And sometimes it can get you through. So, Nikki, how do you advise people to go about putting a marketing plan together for them that they can really believe in, that they can really connect with? And I mean, obviously it starts off with really believing and connecting with whatever it is you're marketing, but then how do you create a plan that actually brings this to the world and really brings your belief to the world?
Yeah. So I always tell people as a very first step is to remember what marketing is really about and to almost understand the different categories or, you know, funnel stops or customer journey stops along the way, because I think so often people go, oh, okay, my audience is on Instagram, I'm going to use Instagram, or Clubhouse is hot and they're just showing up on Clubhouse talking to people wondering why they're not making money. And it's, you have to sit down and go, okay, this is the product I'm selling. And then start going, what is it going to take for me to take someone who's a complete stranger to wanting to buy my product or service? And I tell people it's just like dating, and it usually helps people get, oh, okay, I get the different steps or phases. But you know, for my single folks out there, maybe you're going through this right now, but you start off by going, where the heck am I going to meet people? Especially now, it's typically, okay, which app do I think is going to be right for the type of person I'm trying to meet? And the same is true for marketing your business. It's where the heck are the people? Where do I think they're spending their time? And then this is where a soul alignment piece kind of sneaks in a little bit as well here is, your audience is likely in more than one spot. So if you know that they're spending time in 4, 5, 10 places, you don't have to be in all those places, but you might as well look at them and ask yourself, where are you going to show up best? What feels the best place for you to, you know, build relationships with people to you? And do your audience want to actually hear from you on that platform? You know, and when you kind of have that nice synergy, then you have step one, which is really figuring out where the people are so that you can show up there.
Just a couple of interesting things you said there that I just wanted to circle back on is absolutely you need to find, as you said, find out where the people are. But then you just said something really interesting and say, just because your people or your target audience is on that platform, it doesn't mean they want to hear from you on that platform necessarily.
Yes. Yeah. And you know, this, I used to teach digital marketing classes, and I remember having this student who came to a course who was teaching, or he had a company that essentially helped people work through or recover from drug addiction. And you think about certain platforms where maybe it was like their family or certain circles were made or professional careers where maybe they didn't want to be associated or be liking your page or following your group or seeing your content and having everybody, that's not necessarily the space that they want to engage with you at. And so, and this is true for a couple of other different businesses. You have to think, what is the headspace of my ideal client or customer or person when they're on this platform? And if you can't create content or an intersection and engagement point, that's going to be in alignment with what they're going there for, they may not want to hear from you. And so rather than, you know, being, you know, who wants to go to the club with their mom? I mean, I don't want to go to the club at all nowadays. I feel so old, but I don't even know if I did when I was younger, but I definitely wouldn't want to go with my mom. And so it's like, if you're the equivalent of a mom in terms of what you're marketing, don't show up to, you know, the club trying to market to people because that's not where they want to hear from you. They maybe want to hear from you, you know, at the doctor's office when they want their mom or the grocery store or something like that.
Now that's a great point, yeah. Because obviously, and I think that part of it is that sometimes we don't think these things through, just like what you said there, and we just jump on things. And I guess the other part is Nikki, that it's so easy to market in so many different channels and so many different platforms. And I think people just get so like blinded by all the shiny lights instead of figuring out which are the ones that will work for me. Or maybe I don't have the bandwidth or the money to go on all these ones. How do you select the correct place to be?
Yeah, so I always have people kind of go down a list, and it starts with, where are your people spending their time? Mm-hmm. And then when you know where they're spending their time, the next thing I always ask is, which platforms automatically, you do a gut reaction, literally you would not spend time there, even if somebody paid you, like you don't want to be there. So you might as well cross it off the list right now. It doesn't mean that you're never going to circle back and invest in it or spend time there. But it's, for most people, you don't need to be on all of these places. So you might as well choose platforms, whether it's online or offline, that you enjoy. And then from there, it's really about capacity. And it's, what do you have the capacity to show up on? You know, if you know your audience is on YouTube and you like YouTube, but you realize you don't have the capacity to create YouTube videos, then maybe you cut off YouTube from your list. And so you go through the actual content capacity, the time capacity. The thing that I think a lot of people don't realize is when you try to be on all these platforms, I use this analogy, it's the equivalent of me trying to run a race against an Olympic, you know, track and fielder, because they've been doing this their whole life. They're an expert, they're masterful at it, and they have a lot of resources and training. And then there's me that's like, yeah, I could totally run next to you. And that's the same if you try to be on every platform comparing yourself to, you know, Fortune 100 companies. And I used to work for them. We had a huge team of people, and each person was responsible for maybe 1 to 2 platforms. And so when you are a small team, or maybe you have 1 or 2 people working on your platform or on your business, you may only have the capacity for each person to tackle one platform.
Yeah, no, that makes total sense, because otherwise what you end up doing is kind of doing a lot of things not very well and not really making an impact. Because to your point, if you're competing against companies that have massive budgets, then you've got to get a little creative. If you try to go up against them, it's like your analogy. It's like trying to, you know, play against a professional when you are a rank amateur.
Yeah. And I think that so many people forget that, you know, back in the day, and I'm thinking really pre-internet, there weren't that many opportunities to market. It's, you had, you know, TV, radio, magazines, right, newspapers, yeah, and then direct mail, essentially. Mm-hmm. And so when the internet came, it's great because a lot of small businesses have now have a lot more opportunities to market. But on the flip side, you have a lot more opportunities to market and you can easily try to show up everywhere. And then it's, I think it's worse to try to be everywhere and do a really cruddy job than to choose one place and be the rock star, like the person that's constantly putting out amazing content, engaging with people on DMs. You think about it, every platform today, every time you turn around, they are adding new features. And so if you were at one point trying to be on Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, you know, Twitter, and YouTube, and then you find out, well, I was on Instagram. Instagram's where I really enjoy, but now I could do, you know, stories, reels, IGTV, going live. It's like you could spend all of your time on just a couple of platforms on Instagram alone.
No, absolutely. And one of the other things that you mentioned there I want to come back to is the quality content, because that's another area I think where a lot of people fall down. And, you know, I've said it before, is that, you know, if everybody's creating content, who's actually reading it and who's consuming it? Because there's a lot of bad content. And I think that that's a starting point, is make sure the content that you're sharing is actually good quality and valuable content, because otherwise you're just adding to the noise, and there's a lot of people adding to the noise.
Yeah. And I think where people tend to go wrong is not starting with simple questions that you ask yourself before you create any piece of content. And if you just ask yourself, you know, what is the point of this piece of content? What do you want somebody to do or feel from consuming it? Is this supposed to be just funny, lighthearted? Is it supposed to be informative? Are you trying to make a sale? Who is the person that you want to engage with this? When you ask yourself some of those questions, like, what are they dealing with such that this information would be valuable? Then when you create the piece of content, you have the person and the whole point of the piece of content in mind. And I think sometimes people go, ooh, idea, I'm just going to create this content piece because it's a hot topic right now, or it would be cool. And you're just writing something or recording a video, and outside of maybe your mom and you and like, or a loved one, nobody else really cares. And you're just adding to the information overload out there.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think that's a common trap that people fall into. And then the problem is then they just say, oh, well, then maybe I need to just create more and more and more. And eventually, if I just keep creating, something will click. So how do you advise people, especially around content, right? How do you advise people to create quality content, and what formats should that look, and what should that look like?
Yeah. So the first thing is that there are different types of content, even just strategically. And so, mm-hmm. you know, we mentioned earlier, where are your people hanging out? And then you'll have some content where the only goal for that piece of content is to capture somebody's attention and maybe even get them to do something that allows you to contact with them again, whether that's they send you a DM, they sign up for your email list, they text you. And so you have some content where it's purely lead generating or sometimes interest generating content. You know, they follow you on Instagram. That's the only point of that content. And so whatever the type of content that you're creating, you have to first be clear on what is the point of it. And so you may have content that's purely for that. You may have content that's purely to change the way somebody thinks about your product or your industry. And you may also have content that's sales directive. And so once you're clear on what type of content you're creating, then you go down to, okay, am I doing audio? Am I writing? Am I doing video? Is it short form content, or what I like to call micro content, or is it long form content where it could be, you know, a podcast episode or a 30 minute video or something, or a 5 minute video? It depends on what long form content looks like to you. But once you're clear on what type of content it is it long form or short form, and who it's for. It's really just about making sure that it is engaging throughout the entire thing. And so sometimes that means making sure that there's inflections in your voice, or making sure that there's movement and you have things pop up and you know, text so that people keep paying attention, or that you know when to cut it and just go, yeah. Okay, this was supposed to be 30 minutes, but it's not worth 30 minutes of time. So we're going to cut this to 15 minutes or 10 minutes. So I think those are just some of the big bucket tips. And then there are tons of tips online in terms of how do you make it look really nice in terms of, you know, lighting, mics, things along those lines. But, you know, you can look that online. I think the important thing is how do you make it punchy, engaging throughout the entire piece, and something that somebody would want to sit through or consume for its entirety. Yeah,
absolutely. And one of the things that you referenced there, as I just wanted to come back to, is this idea sometimes is when you get when they get any level of engagement, it's like, oh, fantastic, let's jump on this. You know, I mean, like leap off like a, you know, WWE wrestler and jump on top of the person immediately. When that's not appropriate, you have to nurture it, and that's not appropriate. That's a great way of switching people off.
It is. And I always say, you know, for most people, if you walk up to someone and go, hi, will you marry me? It's going to be a bit like, what is with this person, right? Yeah. And so, or somebody says hi to you and you try to kiss them and you've never met them before. It's kind of like, whoa, person, like back off. And so you want to avoid doing those sorts of things with your marketing. So they're humans. You're communicating with another human being. And so just try to be as natural and normal as possible from the standpoint of how you would communicate with anybody. And so if somebody engages with something or they comment, right? Thank you so much for the comment. Oh my goodness, you felt this way too. Tell me more about it. Hey, you know, I'm here. If you have any questions, send me a DM. Just be how you would if you were meeting with this person online or you saw them in person. And supposed to, you know, I'm jumping on you, you know, smackdown.
Yeah, smackdown. Yeah, but you know, it's totally true. And I think that's the drawback sometimes with technology, is that it allows people to forget that there's a human at the other end, or forget that they're talking to a human, and they just think, oh, look at this, I've got all this technology, and look, oh, that person just engaged. Oh, where's my, I'm going to kick off this campaign immediately to them, or whatever it is. And I think we have to step back and remind ourselves, you know, that there are humans behind it. And also, I think this predated the pandemic, to be honest. But I think the pandemic really like increased it or magnified it. And I think people crave more authentic and human engagement. I think people are understand that there's technologies out there that you can just bombard people with, and they don't want that anymore. They want to know behind it there's some level of human engagement.
Absolutely. And some of the things that work really well for me, so guys, if you want to like write this down or take it on, and it could be time intensive, but I try to engage with people as human beings all the time. So if somebody asks me a question in a comment, and I know that the answer is going to be longer than a quick, you know, just do this, I'll send them a voice memo, because I'm really quick with voice memos on Instagram. And people, I do it, as in all honesty, I started doing it because it was convenient for me and I like helping people, but I find it easier to send a voice memo than to type. People are like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you just sent me a voice memo. This is amazing. You're so sweet. You're like giving me time. And it's, people crave that connection and they like hearing the sound of your voice and they like feeling special. And so any way that you can do that on a simple scale, or you can even scale it sometimes if you have questions, you know, people ask all the time, it's record a quick video and send it to the person saying, hey, I get this question asked all the time. I created a video. Let me know what you think, or if it's helpful. It's simple things you can do that makes it feel like you're not just treating people as if they are, you know, a number in your list of people that could potentially buy from you. They're an actual breathing human with heart and soul.
Yeah. And it's a great point that you just made there, because not only did you say you create the video or the voice memo for that person, but then you say, was this helpful, or is there something else? So it's almost like you're co-opting that person into the process.
Absolutely. And I think so often people are afraid to give too much of themselves because they're afraid then people won't buy. And it's not like I'm giving away, you know, 3-hour calls or consultations. I just go, hey, here's what I think. Hope this is helpful. If you need any more, like I have, we can absolutely talk about what is possible for us. But for the most part, I consider all of this as dates. You know, I mentioned a little bit earlier, it's just like dating. So my first date, we're texting between dates, we're getting to know each other and making it so that people can decide powerfully whether my programming or offerings are right for them or not.
So just one last question, Nikki, then. What is your prediction for the future? Where do you think marketing is headed?
Ooh, that is a great question. I think that this pandemic, in all honesty, did some interesting things to marketing, because I think pre-pandemic, people could, you know, do really big events that were like thousands of people. And it was kind of like, we're just mass marketing and getting everybody to rush to the end of the stage and sell things. Or it was like ads, crazy, like just ads here, ads there. And I think people have felt disconnected or like have been at least craving connection so much that I think one of two things are going to happen. I think either the pendulum's going to swing a little bit more towards you're going to have to put in a lot more effort to be relatable and to be like show your personality. And I'm sure some people will figure out how to do this to scale. But I think more people are going to crave the I'm getting special attention than I was just a number in a room and got some value and you could never know my name and it's fine and I walk out. And so I think that's where things are going to go. The thing I'm curious about is if it's going to be an immediate short-term thing where people want more intimate, you know, more community-esque type of marketing experiences, and that's the way it's going to be moving forward, or if it's going to be a short-term thing and then it's going to go right back to the way it was. And I honestly hope it doesn't, because I don't like those experiences.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think to some degree it will, but I don't think it will totally, because I think in many ways the pandemic has, it's given people an opportunity to stop and kind of consider the world they live in. And I think, and then when people were restricted, I think it made it even more so that they had to consider it. And I think, I think you're correct. I think the more intimate, the more personal stuff is going to endure. Yes, we will get back to big events and that, but I think people would be dissatisfied with the old format.
I agree. And I think people's, for lack of a better word, like BS or like, you know, phony meter is much higher. And, you know, I've watched some content from people and I'm like, wow, you're literally just like, I can tell that you're just doing this to make sales. And I can, and if I'm sensitive to it and I'm a marketer, I can tell like other people are sensitive to it. Or I had somebody on my team watch something and they're not marketers. And they were like, I didn't like that person. I don't know why, I just didn't like them. I'm like, I know why. I know what you were feeling. But I think people are just more sensitive to things like that right now because they're looking for more connection and real talk and to get to know someone and feel like they have their back.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, listen, Nikki, this is fantastic. All of Nikki's information is going to be below this video, including links to her book and her website, etc. But before we go, please do tell people a little bit more about yourself.
Yeah, so I am a Jersey girl, as we mentioned a little bit earlier. And long story short, after a career in corporate marketing, I worked at big brands and then some Fortune 100 companies for about a decade. I left and said, you know what? I want to help people build their own businesses, and specifically people who have stories, knowledge, and expertise in area, and help them be profitable, because I saw so many people go, hey, I'm leaving corporate or I'm leaving a job because I'm unfulfilled, try to go out on their own as whether it was a consultant or an author or a speaker, and then not make it because they weren't able to build their audience enough or have a solid plan or generate enough leads and fill their pipeline. And I'm like, oh, I love that stuff. I can do that all day, every day. So that's kind of where this business came and where the Market Your Genius brand came from, is really about how do you take your zone of genius and package it and promote it in a way that is a win-win for the people who buy from you and for your business.
Yeah, listen, fantastic. Listen, thanks again, Nikki. My name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. I will see you all for another interview really soon. Thank you.